Now for something inspiringly and beautifully different. Find the right pocket. Let me introduce. Who's next? You know, you have the program. Oh, that's you. Okay. This is Ana Sofia Gonzalez, who is at the Harvard Extension School Environmental Program. And she's been working with us for several months. And for a young woman, has a remarkable collection of experiences and education and passions and devotion.
It's on.
You're on, and where are you? There you are.
Can you hear me? Yeah? Climate migrants might reach 1 billion by 2050. And these are five reasons why we should care. The first reason is that migration is a climate issue. But how? How are these two different problems related? Well, the greenhouse gas emissions that we have been putting on the atmosphere are changing the climate patterns. We know that. And the most important effects of these patterns is the precipitation patterns. We're going to start having more rain, where is a lot of rain, but also we're going to be having less water in dry lands, in desert lands. So there is three main effects of climate that are affecting human population. Because yes, climate change is about nature, it's about the environment, it's about plants and animals, but also it's about humans. They're affecting humans so much that it's causing complete communities to move to other places in order to survive. So the first effect that impacts human population is droughts and desertification. I grew up in the north of Mexico, in the northeast part, a very important agricultural region in the desert of Sonora. When I was growing up, there was a 10-year drought. This affected a lot of farmers because they had to invest more and more money to pump the water from the aquifer. The soils desertified and they became more saline. And a lot of farmers just couldn't keep up. There was too much money to invest. The soils were getting depleted too fast. They couldn't keep up with the yields. And they had to sell or abandon their lives, their lands, and go and migrate somewhere else to look for better opportunities. A lot of them crossed the border to the United States. Another way that climate change impacts human population is as a conflict multiplier. Jennifer Leaning from Harvard University explains this relation with example of Syria. In 2008, there was a very severe drought in Syria that lasted 4 years. The most affected part of Syria was in the northeastern, where the Sunnis had their farms. In this place, you could find high heat, dry soils, and complete collapse of agriculture in these years. So millions of Sunnis migrate to another cities, most of the cities ruled by Al-Assad. And these create social disruption in these cities. The Sunnis were discriminated. They couldn't find jobs. The housing was a huge issue. And then the conflicts arose. And it ended up in a very serious war. And we know that the refugee crisis that Europe is facing right now is mostly because of this war, Syrian war. And I'm not saying that this drought was the main cause of the Syrian war, but it was definitely a major contributor. And also, there is the other part, no, the other effects that are affecting human population. And it will increase. The effect will increase. So it's the sea level rise, the floods, and the storms that we're seeing right now. This is a map of Florida on 2030. This is Tampa, Florida. And we can see how the floods come all the way to the city center. And if this is scary, we can also see this is Boston in 2050. Actually, this map is the city of Boston made this initiative. It's public, and you can visit in the website. It's called Climate Ready Boston. And it's an interactive map, and you can play with it. You can play with different layers, different parts of the cities. But I chose this one. It's the annual coastal flood by 2050. And these floods, the storms, will affect people, will affect the houses of these people, their jobs. And it will make them move, migrate. We can't keep ignoring this situation. We can't keep turning our faces from this problem, because it is urgent, and we know it. We lived this year. This is Houston a couple of months ago. This is Puerto Rico. And actually, Rick Scott, the governor of Florida, declared last month that 75,000 Puerto Ricans arrived to Florida since Hurricane Maria. People are moving because they can't keep living where they were born into. But we also have problems here. This is California, the fires in California. 2017 was the second hottest year ever recorded. The first one was 2015. So, believe it or not, climate change is happening, and it's happening now. And we also have to recognize the climate justice, which is the third reason why we should care about climate migration. Because yes, we need to make a commitment to reduce our emissions as developed countries. But also, we need to make a commitment with those people that are being affected right now. Because this map is showing the CO2 per person emitted. The darkest orange is the countries that emit most CO2 per person. And we can see that the United States is a big contributor, but also Europe and basically the Northern Territory. And we can see that Africa does not impact the climate change that much, or Southeast Asia, or even Central America. But in this other map, we see that the projected impact of climate change on agricultural yields will affect these countries the most. So is this fair? Is this really fair? We need to be responsible as developed countries of what is happening in the world right now. We need to make a commitment to these people that are being affected. And we can say, okay, I live in Cambridge. How does this affect me? Well, migration affects everyone. This is what I was trying to say here, but there was a... Migration affects everyone. Not only the countries that are being flooded or that are being desertified, but also the countries where these people are coming to. Because we mix different cultures, we mix different religions, and these create tensions. And we can see in this map that a lot of the people that are being affected are coming either to Europe or to the United States. So this is how a climate migration crisis looks in a map, in numbers, in statistics. But in real life, The climate migration crisis looked like this. Broken families. People risking their lives to get to another country in order to survive. Social disruption. These are Syrian immigrants sleeping under a train station in Budapest. And climate migrants doesn't have the status of refugees. This means that they are irregular immigrants. They are illegal immigrants. 20% of the immigrants are irregular. And this means they cannot get jobs where they arrive to. It's very difficult for them to get involved in the economical systems, in the social systems on the countries where they arrive. And 20% of migrants are children. This means these children cannot get proper education, and they are very vulnerable to exploitation, to forced labor. And if human suffering, if millions of people suffering is not enough to care, then let me tell you about the network effects. The military defense budget will increase, and that will come from your taxes, because the conflicts will be more intense. The unemployment rates will arise, not only in the countries, in the underdeveloped countries, but also here, also in Europe, also in the United States. This might compromise security, national security, or even international security. Millions of kids lacking education. This is a very important fact, because we're going to have all these children growing up and being unable to get a job. Of course, the economy is impacted. You are impacted. I am impacted. But the most important reason why you should care about climate migration is because you can do something about it. We can work on prevention. We can increase rural conditions, support local agriculture, even introduce sustainable practices. Think about restoration, about long-term fertility of the farms. Maybe we can even increase the resilience of these farms, so when climate change hits them, they don't collapse, basically. We can introduce crop diversification, agroforestry. Climate migration is fundamentally an issue of people that cannot make a living in the place where they were born into. So maybe we can prevent this. But also we have to acknowledge that a lot of people will have to move either way. But also we have a lot of land to restore. We have a lot of deserts to regenerate. And we have a lot of people that need jobs. So maybe we can create restoration hubs where we can employ all these migrants so they can have a dignified job, a dignified life, where they can have a land to nurture. What if we could live in a world where we can have an inclusive immigration strategy, where we recognize climate justice, where developed countries make themselves responsible for the damage they've done to the environment? What if we can give education to these kids? What if we could create and support local communities so these people don't even have to migrate from the land where they were born into? Well, I believe there is hope. And I know that if you're here sitting in this conference, you also believe there is hope. Because this is what this conference is all about, hope. And that's why we're here, surrounded of experts, sharing ideas, learning from experts of agriculture and fertility and ocean restoration, education. That's why we are here. And I want to ask you all that this weekend, when you are learning about these things and sharing these ideas and creating these strategies and solutions for the challenges that we are facing as a humanity? Yes, do it for the plants, do it for the environment, do it for the forest, for the animals, for the polar bears. But most importantly, do it for the people. Do it for us. Do it for them. And I want to thank every one of you sitting here tonight, because you are the reason why there is hope, because you care. Thank you.